Well, hello everybody. I'm sort of sitting here, kind of last night I was taking care of some stuff on the page, and suddenly I saw this thing pop up to 100,000 subscribers. I'm really kind of in a state of shock. You know, I mean, I've been watching the numbers go up and stuff, but it's really amazing that we've managed to build a community like this. Rick Beato wrote me, and he sent me a really great note. He's a funny cat. I'm really glad that I hooked up with him on YouTube and got all this going. I really appreciate his input to me on doing this and kind of helping along, because his site's amazing, and he has such a profound wealth of information. But so I really appreciate all of you joining me here. I'm enjoying this really so much that I intend to keep this up, no matter what the state of the world. I will be here, because it's making me think about things that I haven't thought about in a long time. You know, trying to figure out what might be interesting, and what, maybe being able to educate people on things they were unaware of, or just give them another insight into stuff they were aware of. And some people are writing to me about things I haven't thought about in a long, long time, and I'm going to start digging them up. But there's lots to come, so don't, if I haven't done, something you want to hear, there's going to be plenty of time. I've still got a few miles left on these tires, so I'm gonna keep at it. Now, and today there was a suggestion. A couple of people suggested this, because I think I threw in a name, and I'm gonna do more of a little kind of a tutorial educational thing, and then we'll play a song. But one of the greatest things in the music business history was the Brill Building in New York City. Now, this is a skyscraper basically that was built in 1931, and served different purposes throughout the years. At this point, I think the bottom of it is a CVS pharmacy. But in its really great heyday in the 50s and 60s, this is the building where all the songwriters had cubicles and just cranked out material. It was a factory, a music factory in there. And I wrote down some of the names of people who worked in that building doing their songs. Now, I mean, this is the who's who. I didn't bring my keys up. This has nothing to do with me. I'm passing along information about who was there, not who I was, being with or anything like that. So no keys. Like, no jacket required. This is no keys required for this. But Carole King and Jerry Goffin. I mean, Goffin and King were one of the great songwriting teams, and they worked in the Brill Building, had their little cubicle in there, and they would work. Jerry did most of the lyrics, and Carole wrote the music. There was a lot of team efforts in those places. And the thing that's remarkable is, like, Carole was a teenager when she was writing some of her biggest hits. And they're like the Locomotion and songs. I mean, it was amazing when we started with James Taylor in 1970, and she was the piano player. She had this incredible history as a songwriter, and nobody really knew who she was. You know, she was just Goffin and King. So you had Carole King and Jerry Goffin. You had Barry Mann and Cynthia Weil. I mean, I think they wrote "You've Lost That Lovin' Feelin'" for the Righteous Brothers. Lieber and Stoller. I mean, it's all these iconic teams. Holland Dozier Holland, Lamont Dozier. If you ever are watching any Phil Collins videos and you see "Wish It Would Rain" video, it's Lamont Dozier playing the piano, and he's sitting at the piano. I mean, that was a really fun video to make, pretty whimsical. Burt Bacharach and Hal David. I've done lots and lots of work with Bert and Hal over the years, and it was really fun. We do a gig every year. It was put off this year because of pandemic, and it's really heartbreaking that it didn't happen. But we do a gig every year at the Library of Congress in Washington for ASCAP, the music publishing company. And what they do is they bring in maybe 8 different artists who are ASCAP artists. And the room is full of, well, it's full of like senators and stuff. So I'm not going to go into that. But it's basically ASCAP presenting them, you know, what music writing is all about. And it's, and the primary thing is to lobby them to protect songwriters' rights, because you can get screwed so fast in this business. So it's a really worthwhile thing that ASCAP does. And for a long time, Hal David was the head of ASCAP, and Paul Williams has been for a number of years now the president of ASCAP, and he's doing an amazing job. But it was funny. So we would have different people like Randy Newman and Jimmy Webb. And what they do is they would come in and tell a story about songwriting. And then I was part of a small house band every year, and we would back the people and do their songs with them. And it's really cool. There's some YouTubes of past shows. If you go on YouTube and look up We Write the Songs, ASCAP. It's good, but the event we do is called We Write the Songs. But it was really, really sweet. We talked Hal David into doing one of the songs, like Raindrops Keep Falling on My Head. I forget what the song was. And Hal was close to 90 years old at that point. And Hal was really nervous about it. We really had to hustle him to get him to get up and do it. And so he finally came up and we did the song. And it was so charming and so sweet. And when we finished, Hal went, "Can we go on the road?" It's like, it went from terrified to let's hit the road, let's do it. And Hal passed a couple of years ago, but he was a beautiful, beautiful soul. And he and Burt Bacharach were probably one of the greatest songwriting teams ever. All the stuff they wrote for Dionne Warwick and stuff like that. Neil Diamond was one of the writers in the Brill Building. Bobby Darin was. Johnny Mercer, Lauren Nero, it's incredible. Marvin Hamlisch, Boyce and Hart, David Gates, who formed Bread. I mean, it's a remarkable, remarkable, remarkable history that that occupied that building, and they could hear each other from room to room. I mean, it's like everybody's trying to come up with something and they would hear something from another room. I mean, I can't imagine what the energy would have been in there. I've done a lot of work with Steve Tyrell over the years, and he's a very dear friend, keys dropping. And he was part of that whole scene too. And but some of the greatest songs of that entire era of the late 50s up to the 70s came out of the Brill Building. And one of the writers who really cranked out tons of songs and had an incredible career as a young man, really a kind of a teenage phenom, was Neil Sedaka. And Neil, one of his writing partners was Howard Greenfield, and they did a lot of songs together. And it was really cool. Neil rode really high, had a really fabulous career, and then it. Sorry. God, you just look at the computer for 1 second. Give me one moment here to digress. Come on, don't do this to me. Oh God, I think we've got it here. I'm gonna just get to, oh God. You know, I'm trying to
stuck
be
at home?
Yeah, stuck at home, you schmuck. Jesus.
I have a free piano workshop.
Oh, that's so nice for you.
Where I'm going to talk
about. So nice for you.
How's that?
Oh, hold on. Okay, I am really so tired of this crap with it. I mean, I kind of just glance over and it just like it starts going. I think I need to reduce the intensity of my glance. But Neil, like I was saying, Neil had this amazing career as a young man, and then, yeah, you know, things kind of, you know, like the business does, it ebb and flows, and then things weren't that great for him for a number of years. But then he, Elton John, it turns out, was a huge fan of Neil's writing, and Neil's a great pianist, and he has a great voice. And, I mean, just everything about Neil was really, really pretty special. And so when Elton formed Rocket Records back in the day, in the 70s, he signed Neil to the label, and we were really, really? One more ring and then it'll be off. You know, I'm really trying hard to be professional. I am such a wanker when it comes to this stuff. It's unbelievable. It's amateur night at the Sklar funhouse here. Okay, so Neil got signed to Rocket Records, and I was fortunate to get called to do his comeback album. And actually the Section did this. We worked with Robert A. Pear, engineering and producing the album at Clover Records in Hollywood. And Robert did a couple of our Section albums with us. Robert's a great engineer. I think he eventually he's been doing film engineering for a number of years now. But terrific, terrific engineer, terrific studio. We did all kinds of album projects in Clover, and its history was great. And plus, a half a block away, there was a great Mexican restaurant that made one of the best chimichangas I've ever had. So, yeah, it was, when you talk with musicians, generally it eventually revolves around food. Like you talk about gigs you've done on the road, and the first thing somebody goes, oh, there's this great restaurant. You know, and everybody makes a beeline towards it. But it was pretty much the Section that did this. It was myself and Danny Korchmar and Russ Kunkel and Craig Derge on keyboards, and also Jim Horn played sax on it. And Jim was a part of the Wrecking Crew, and Jim played on our first Section album. And great, great player. So we did this in 1975, and the album was called, I believe it was Sedaka's Back. And one of the songs we did on it was Laughter in the Rain, which became a number one hit. And the whole album had great, great songs on it. And I loved working with Neil. We spent some time, we did some TV together and some live shows. But he's such a great musician. And Phil Cody wrote the lyrics to Laughter in the Rain. And the story goes that Phil Cody smoked a bunch of dope, passed out under a tree. And when he woke up, he wrote these lyrics in 5 minutes. You know, it's 5 minutes that probably bought him a big chunk of the rest of his life. It's amazing. But so I was going to play along with this, but I love the bass part on this so much. And to go back and try to relearn this part to do this video really wouldn't have done it the justice that it deserves, because this track with the Section playing on it and everything is really good. And I so love the way the bass turned out on this track, that I'd rather just sit with you and listen to it. But this is Neil Sedaka's comeback, and this was his number one hit that came out of his comeback. And Neil's still out there working. Boy, he is a force of nature, still out gigging. I mean, not right at this moment, because nobody is, but he's still, you know, very active. And I love that I have Neil in my life. He's a really special cat. So here's Laughter in the Rain, the way we did it in 1975. Thank you. better like this. Frankenstein on this. It's just a great pop record. I mean, it may not be everybody's, you know, taste. That's the one thing that I've enjoyed of having been doing this now for a shade over 50 years. I've really enjoyed that I've gotten to work with not only different artists, but different genres and different styles. You know, getting to record with Johnny Mathis and people like that. And God, you know, the mind blanks. That whole period, and then eventually Neil ended up leaving Rocket Records. They had some internal things going on, and he moved on. But like I said, he's still outperforming, and I think he's still probably recording. And I think somebody told me that he's been posting some house performances on YouTube. So I'm going to go check that out and see what Neil's up to, and you may want to also. But there was a bunch of songs from that album that were really, really good songs. And it was a great time because we got to do so much work as the section on people's records. So there was a thing that the minute we walked in, it was that because we knew each other so well and we had played together so much and everybody was at the top of their game. So these things came together really quick. I mean, Neil sat down at the piano and just played the song for us, and we sussed out quick charts on it and probably got that in a take or two. It's a funny business because so many times you can come in and people are almost bugged that they had to pay you even your union money because they said, oh God, you're only here, you know, 45 minutes. Well, it took me 45 years to figure out how to get in and out in 45 minutes. Go hire somebody who doesn't understand what this is all about and let them sit there. I found myself where I did a project for a guy who said he was really on a tight budget and all this. And I kind of knew him, so I cut him a really good deal. And I went in and we had like 5 hours and I cut 9 or 10 tracks. It was overdubbing bass for him. And so I did all these things in like 4 or 5 hours. And then he went back to England and he had a bass player in England. There were 3 other tracks left to go. And that bass player took 3 days to do the 3 songs. And at the end of the day, he got paid for 3 days' work and I got paid for 5 hours' work. And I started rethinking how I approached this this business, because it's really hard to drag things out. I mean, I'm really at my best if I've got some kind of a guide to start with, some kind of chord sheet or something simple, just so I'm not spending all my time listening to the song, trying to figure it all out. If I have something I can look at and kind of jump right into it. My best takes are going to be my first or second take on most pieces of material, unless they're incredibly complicated and require a bunch of sussing out. But you live and learn. I mean, that's the one thing about this gig is every day is a new adventure. No matter how long you've been doing it, there's going to be, something's going to come and you go, it's like Merle Haggard saying, my singing teeth arrived. Or when I was working with, Andy Griffith, and he looked at me and he said, who'd have thought I have all this beautiful white hair and Opie be bald? There's every day, guys, something new happens and it makes you go, I'm so glad I do this. I'm so glad and fortunate that this is my gig. So I'm rambling on here. I just sort of just wanted to hear that song. I really, really love the way it turned out. I'll play tomorrow. I'll find a song to play tomorrow and I will play. And just looking at all kinds of different material, and it's really fun because some stuff that I'm finding I hadn't heard in so long. And I go, God, that was really cool. Or memories that come back from that experience. There was a Neil story, but I'm going to leave it. I don't know if Neil would want me to tell it. So I'm just going to say, have a great day out there. Be good to you, to yourself. Be good to your friends and family. Think about the people that are out there still every day. Nothing's going away in terms of our health issues. So, be cognizant that there's people out there working really hard every day. And all the teachers, that schools are still shut, so, and schools still in session. So teachers that are still doing all the homeschooling, remotely. My niece and her husband are both teachers and they're homeschooling their children and still carrying on their workloads for their students. I mean, it's a lot of work that they're going through, but essential work. We can't just abandon a year or something out of children's education and say, well, when conditions get better, then they'll get back in school. No, this is an ongoing process and it's hard. And it's kind of relearning things every day. And so I think that ding means that my turkeys, it's becoming insistent. So I'm going to sign off and I will see you tomorrow. And again, thank you all so much for subscribing here and hitting 100,000. I mean, I don't ultimately know what it means. I guess if it was a dollar a subscription, I'd be rocking, but it's just the love of being here is what we're here for. And I really appreciate all of you. And I keep reading. I read every one of your posts that comes. I spend my evening, climb in bed late at night, and I just sit there and go through all of them, try to answer some, but there's a lot. But you're all in my heart and my thoughts, and I wish the best for everybody. So I will upload this now, and then I will talk to you later. And I'm going to go meet with the guy who is going to be helping me organize my finger book. And I want to get that going pretty soon so that everybody can maybe jump in and buy a coffee table book of people giving me the finger. Kinky. Talk to you later. Bye-bye.